filling out the list I started on the board that gives some examples of branches of philosophy. We only got through a couple of branches. We didn't even get clear through them, but to give you an idea of what we're talking about, there's different, when we say different, types of philosophy, different philosophical areas. As you can imagine, there are, in most disciplines, several branches of those disciplines. If you ask somebody what they do for a living, they say, I'm a scientist. That doesn't tell you very much, does it? That doesn't narrow it down enough. You want to say, well, what kind of scientist? Are you looking, are you looking at pond scum for single-celled creatures? Are you instead using a particle accelerator? You're colliding particles at very high speeds so that you can look at the resulting particles that fly off of the collision and do the math. Or, as a scientist, are you just taking a census of hummingbirds that are crossing the Gulf of Mexico during March? And those things they're hardly even related. Well, in philosophy, there's branches also, just like there are in every other pursuit. Big umbrella pursuit or a little tiny pursuit. If I say, what are you going to do when you're all done with your education and you're settled into your profession? You say, I'm going to be a physician. That really doesn't tell me what kind of a life you're going to have at all. You know, what are you going to be, first of all, clinical or research? Are you going to be a radiologist or a proctologist or an OB or a psychiatrist, an ER doc? Those actual professions aren't even really similar to each other. They're not really similar at all. Your lifestyle is different. Your business is different. What you're doing is different. Your training is different. You probably don't know how to do any of those other things if you're just one of them. You wouldn't know any more than anyone else how to do it. So it's by saying you're going to be in medicine or you're going to be a physician, that's a big umbrella. And by saying philosophy, that's a big umbrella. So under it, a person who's a philosopher could be doing some very different kinds of things. Now, as in medicine, you could say, well, if you're in medicine, if you're a physician, then somehow you're contributing to helping to alleviate some sort of non-wellness, some sort of pathology. You're trying to promote people being well instead of being sick, or to fix people that break or that diseases or whatever. Whether you're researching, looking for ways that other physicians that are clinical physicians can apply the things that you find out, or whether you are an administrative physician, you're not even treating people, you're supervising other physicians that are treating people, and you need a background to do that. In philosophy, you could have somebody whose whole deal for their whole life is to keep tripping out and drilling down, trying to figure out stranger and stranger things about the nature of existence, if there is such a thing. And even the question of existence of existence is a meta mind blower. Or instead, as a philosopher, you could be spending your time trying to figure out ethics, and that's all you do. You don't ever worry about ontology. You don't ever worry about origins. You don't worry that much, really, about epistemology, and unless it overlaps with trying to figure out what is the nature of good behavior, of how we should act in community toward one another. And ethics, of course, is a branch of philosophy. You'll find that there's some things that ethics and aesthetics have in common, right? Ethics is based on how you ought to act toward one another or in groups in society, in city, in the country, whatever, towards your fellow human beings. But that, who's to say? You know, who's that up to? That somebody gets to decide, oh, okay, well, you get to decide. On what basis? Who says? Does that make it real? Even if one country says, well, here's the kind of people who make those decisions. And then you go to another country, and people say, what, you have people like that making, that kind of person makes a decision? What, are you guys crazy? What do they have to do with it? No, no, here's the person who decides that. For a long time, that has been the domain of clerics, of priests and shamans and that sort of thing. People that supposedly have some sort of connection with the divine or with the out-of-here-ness. And so then we find out the basis for what's right and what's wrong. We get some sort of rules that get handed, like the Ten Commandments, or prophecies that somebody is told what you're doing is wrong and you can't act that way. Or somebody gets a vision that says that we don't eat this particular kind of creature. That's wrong to eat that kind of creature because we live in some relationship with that creature. Now, in this country, in the United States, if you go to Safeway and you look and there's lamb and turkey, and fish of different kinds, and chicken, and there's no dog. There's no dog and there's no horse and there's no cat. Why would there be no dog and no horse and no cat? There's pig. The pig is actually probably smarter than the cat and the horse. And some pigs are smarter than some dogs. They're able to live with a similar domestic relationship and love and loyalty and everything with us. They're a little bit cleaner than any of those other animals. We just have decided for some reason, somehow, that in this country we eat pigs. But pigs have been forbidden in to be eaten in many cultures over time. Horse is okay to eat almost everywhere. It's bizarre that in the United States you don't eat horse. Why would you not eat horse? Well, because we have some sort of imagined species relationship with the horse. So we don't eat that. If somebody said, hey, we're eating ostrich, well, that's all right. We're eating buffalo, yeah, okay. We're eating, you know, all kinds of weird things. People go, I'm having snake or whatever. But you don't eat horse. And you don't eat dog and you don't eat cat. You don't serve it at your restaurant. It's not dangerous any more than, I mean, we serve things that are downright dangerous. There's sea creatures that if you don't get certain parts of their bodies completely separate from the diner, it'll kill them where they sit at the table. But that's okay. We can serve that. But there's nothing dangerous about eating a horse or a dog. We just have a thing about it. So what makes it right and wrong? Who is that up to? Say, oh, well, the government. Well, I mean, come on. So in which state? You know, people that kind of start thinking about, well, if it's wrong here, how can it be right there? I can go over here, and I can go to Canada, and I can eat horse. But I can't eat horse here. So we have to start saying, what the heck? Is that real at all? That's in a similar category with what we consider to be beautiful and what we consider to be ugly. There's foods that, now we'll pick on food again. There's foods that are so raunchy smelling to some people and tasting to some people that they can't picture that it's something to eat instead of something to, you know, put on a hazmat suit and carry it out, dispose of it in red bags, make sure it goes in the biohazard pile. And it works both directions between cultures. Have you ever encountered somebody who considers something a delicacy that you consider repulsive? I mean, I think most of us have. Have you ever encountered somebody that considers what you love, they consider it to be repulsive? And then they say, how can you eat that? And they make you feel bad about your dinner. You've ever had that? Well, who's to say whether it's a good taste or a bad taste or a good smell or a bad smell? Or have you ever been with somebody and they comment on how attractive some person is, and you look and you're going, I'm not seeing it. I am not seeing it. And they are just, they're stars, you know, the cartoon stars. And they're like 2 feet off the ground. That is one beautiful person. But you're going, good for you. I won't stand in your way. You don't have to worry about me. Or vice versa. You look at somebody and you go, oh, man. And someone's going, oh, seriously? Are you kidding? Are you being mean? No, I'm serious. I mean, that does it for me. Huh? What is with that? And it seems to us like a fact. Doesn't it really seem? I mean, you look at somebody and you go, that is an incredibly attractive person. It's like, holy moly. And then somebody says, baloney. And you're going, no. I mean, you can argue that and have a fist fight. You know, you can call names and say, somebody must be crazy or blind or, you know, what's the matter with you? And it seems to us like fact, doesn't it? I mean, think of something that you just would not eat. Go back to the food thing. Think of something that is just nasty. I don't know if you've ever smelled durian.
It's so good.
So you like durian, right? Yeah. Has anyone ever smelled durian? You've been in SM or whatever, and you're going, I wouldn't eat that with your mouth. Right? You smelled it? You're not eating it, right? What's it smell like to you? What's it smell like to you?
I don't know.
Heavenly?
It's good.
It's good.
Yeah.
It tastes good, but it doesn't smell good.
Okay, that's like some cheeses.
Yeah.
My rule is, if they don't smell good, I've never found them to taste good either. But I understand that people can go, wow, that smells like vomit, but I can't wait to get it into my mouth. I just can't go there.
What is it?
It's a fruit. I think it grows on a tree, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And it grows in Asian island nations. Is that
Southeast Asia
in islands mostly, right?
Yeah.
Island nations.
Oh, not necessarily.
No.
Malaysia is not an island.
Okay, so it grows there. Okay.
It's kind of bad.
Yes. For that too, you're right. You guys breaking the bank.
Australia, but I want to break it.
Someone else gave it to you?
She gave it.
I thought it was for
you. Bastard.
Oh, well, that one was for you. You had two coming. Great, you're stealing. She deserves it. She likes durian.
That's what it was.
Now, if you think it's nasty, how can she think it's good? She's wrong, isn't she? Oh, different. So if somebody says, I'm going to kill that guy. I'm joking. I mean, I'm going to kill him with a gun. And you say, that's not okay. Who says there's plenty of times where you're supposed to? Who gets to make it up and say, that's for real? And what's the basis? Where do we get that you're supposed to or not supposed to, or that something is a good thing and something else is a bad thing? I'm just fascinated to look at social media these last few months. People that I think, they don't have, I mean, some of them, they're not very smart, but some of them are very, very smart. And yet they're taking positions, political positions, that I just can't fathom how they get there. I just can't fathom how, when they believe this one thing, how they can also entertain this other thing. It's like, and you talk with them, And you say, but you say this. How can that fit with this? And they go, well, it just does. No, it just doesn't. Just diagram it. Oh, no, well, I don't see it like that. No, this is a good thing. Seriously, this is a good thing. I've had discussions with people. This is how maybe intractable these kinds of issues can be. I've had discussions with people where I say, but you said this, and then when you talk about this other subject, you say the opposite thing, and they go, so? That's okay. That's a different subject. It's a different time. I say, yeah, but consistency, if it's true here, isn't it true here? No. And they're not kidding. It's like, why are we talking? And then the person says, who says that you should argue with consistent reasoning from one discussion to the next? Who says that? And I have to say, me. And then they would say, well, I don't know who you think you are. We embrace in Western logic, and by the way, logic is a branch of philosophy. You'll see that on that list that I posted. Logic is a branch of philosophy that it's a set of rules to allow us to reason from one thing that we accept to another thing in ways that we agree are going to give us, if something is true and we reason from that using these rules, we're going to get another true thing come out the other end of those syllogisms, of those machines of reasoning. We think of, you know, we introduce them like distributive property or associative property, that we talk about that in math. Those are actually existing in logic as well as in math. We say if A equals B, we know that, and B equals C, then we can know that A equals C. We accept that that's true, correct? Yes? I promise. In the West, we do say that. And if you ever get that in a math class, go with that. Okay? But I believe that there are people who would say, oh, I don't accept that. Then what do we do? How do we have a discussion? You argue and argue and argue, and you say, yeah, but what you're saying would mean, and then at some point you get to where they say, yeah, that's exactly what it would mean, and I think that's a good thing. And then I say, yeah, but I don't think that's a good thing. I think that's a bad thing. And they say, who says? And I got nothing to say to them except, well, me. And it gets really tough. It doesn't mean they're stupid. She's not stupid for thinking that that durian is nasty, and she's not stupid for thinking that durian is glorious, wonderful to eat. It's just that it comes down to a part where you have to just admit that there's no real basis. It's just what you find pleasant, what you want instead of what you don't want, what you prefer to happen instead of what you hope doesn't happen. And that isn't the same for everybody. And that makes it really tough in a country like ours. We're having discussions even within the Christian community, especially in the Christian community, about whether or not we should be worrying about helping people who don't have any place to go in the world. You know, they can't stay where they're from. It became impossible. They're not allowed to, or it's completely dangerous. And very soon, the reason that we're going to be having this discussion very soon is that it's not there anymore. That their hometown is gone. Not it got blown up, and not, they plowed it and made a parking lot instead for the next town, but it's now underwater. Millions of people are likely to just not have a place to go because I mean, they'd have to scuba dive to get to where they used to live. It's like Lake Berryessa here. I think it's probably, I didn't go out there and go boating during this drought that I guess, I think is probably not an issue anymore. It was an issue a few months ago, but it's not an issue right now, I guess. Other problems, we moved along. But when I was a student here in the 70s and 80s, we had another drought like that. It's just whenever Governor Brown is in office, we have, he's the drought governor. And he had asked people, he set himself up for this because he actually said publicly, everybody needed to do their part, you know, to save water. He said, so if you just go to the toilet and urinate, just don't flush, you know. So then, of course, the Republicans found out that he said that, and then everybody had bumper stickers that said, if it's brown, flush it down. If it's yellow, better help. Yeah, he set himself up for it. He should have seen it coming. Should have advisors for that sort of thing that are clever people, but he missed that one, and it's still. And then he comes back and gets another drought. But when a friend of mine went and we got a boat and we went to Berryessa, you could actually see the places where there had been homes before they made a dam and flooded the thing. It had been a community at the bottom. And so you could see the chimneys and foundations and stuff. Well, that's actually going to happen with parts of the ocean. So then there's going to be people that don't have anywhere to go, and all the other places are claimed. Everything's claimed. So this is mine. Take off. I don't care about you. If you don't have a place, that sucks for you. I have a place. Don't you wish you had a place? So people are having these really heated discussions, and it comes down to having to realize that some people believe you should care for other people, even if it's inconvenient to you. You should make sure that everybody's getting cared for. And other people say, like heck, I believe in survival of the fittest or the luckiest. And right now I'm lucky. It's my turn. So I guess that's too bad for them. I guess it's too bad. And what basis do we have to argue with that?
So I understand how that would apply to, I guess, like small things like food or, you know, like what we kind of practice. But is there any like real basis for like bigger things?
Like that?
Like savings, like war or like murder or stealing. Other things that we can, maybe not all, but that we could be pretty comfortable saying like this is what this is a common basis. Or is everything literally just relative?
I'll just mirror that question to you and say, is it?
I don't know, but it was scary.
I mean, most religious people would say, yes, there is, my religion.
Right.
And then we get dangerous. We think we get dangerous. Because almost always somebody's religion says we should not ought to do those things. Except when we believe God is telling us to do those things to other people. And it turns out most religions have those times. Like genocide, you know. It's fascinating to me, just fascinating to hear people, the Bible thumpers, saying that you can go in the Quran and find commands about doing violence to other people groups. And so obviously that there's nothing that say that makes it okay. Well, to say that it's not in the Bible is kind of silly. I mean, I don't know what universe we go to where that's what it says in the Bible isn't the same thing. And it turns out that when people in a culture need to go to war, they generally have some way to construct their deity going into battle with them. And honoring as holy warriors, the people who inflict the most damage on whoever, is competing for whatever resources that they both want and can't both have. So is there something there's some neuroscientists today. Donald Pfaff is one of them. Neuroscientist, neuropsychologist. He wrote a book and some articles about a theory that that altruism is our default, and it's only that we're trained or cultured to do other than that because we haven't to learn it because our default mechanism is to, when we're about to do something to somebody else, when we follow the way we're wired or the way that we evolved or whatever, we consider first the doing of the thing, we picture the action, then we picture the person that's the recipient of our behavior, then we merge our self-image with theirs in our parietal lobe, and then having done that, we evaluate that behavior as if it was going to be done to us, and then if it's something that would make us uncomfortable, it would be really bad for us, unpleasant, we don't want that happening to us, then that activates in the prefrontal cortex, the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex area, it activates the switch that says, oh, well, don't do that, you wouldn't want that done to you, and this person is you, so you don't do that. So he says he can demonstrate that with brain scans and everything. It's still descriptive, though, right, rather than prescriptive. It doesn't make it what we're supposed to do, right? I mean, to say that because we have a big evolutionary heritage, if somebody is an evolutionist, and they're arguing, well, this is something that's gotten, so you're like competition. But when the Adventist Church started, we were against competition. That was one of our big deals. Now we're not. Now we you know, go pioneers and all of that. That would never happen when this place was born, because it was against our religion. And now, as we acclimate, we sort of resemble more the culture of which we used to be a subculture, and we become watered down, whatever, in the water we're immersed in. So, somebody could say, well, evolution is how we got to where we are. One of the reasons that we're having battles in our denomination where people are kind of rolling their eyes at the absurdity in their cosmopolitan opinion of saying God created the earth is that their reality has been shown that even their own church's value system has now embraced competition. And it's like, well, then you must believe there's something good about it. Well, the broader culture is saying competition is how we got to be as cool as we are and not be slimed in a pond somewhere. So people say, since it got us here, don't argue to reduce it. I mean, it's time-honored. It's our creator. So that argument, in order to fly, would have to mean if something is a very good Darwinian survival strategy, then we should promote it. But by that reasoning, we should promote rape. Because that's an outstanding Darwinian way to behave. You know, what's the percentage of the world's population that has from one man, Genghis Khan, DNA? An enormous percentage of the world's population right now can be shown to have somehow come from Genghis Khan. And so he was raping all over the place. So if that's the game, you know, so we also don't tolerate killing our siblings. But that works out pretty well for birds. Push them out of the nest because then they don't have to compete for the same amount of parental effort. And so we then find that we're picking and choosing. And it comes down to, no matter whether someone's religious or they're anti-religious, it always seems to come down to what they just happen to feel, for whatever reason, comfortable with. What I feel at the time. And that is not probably a reliable basis. We can't run society that way. So then we've opened this huge can of worms that allows your question to just stand right on it and go, yeah, well, yeah, question mark. That's the field of ethics. That's a gnarly field. It's a career. So that's just one little part of philosophy. But it's important because we have these discussions about right now, well, what's really the role of government? What should government do? Should government try to make, and now we're talking about another branch of philosophy, which is political science. That's philosophy. Politics is philosophy. How should we govern ourselves or be governed? What should government be like?
So, like, how do you feel about the when governments...
You put that well, because that fits what we're saying. How do I feel about it is an excellent question.
About, like in New York, how they regulated the size of cups that you can buy for sodas. Like, you can't buy a bottle.
Like the nanny stuff?
Yeah. And, like, I know there's other, like, they're trying to, in New York, trying to pass, like, there's no table salt on,
right.
Like, restaurants, so you don't have the option to add salt.
Yeah.
And there's, like, there's several other ones, like, where
people
they're going
to
have, like,
proposed that fast food companies be required to put statins in with their Big Macs.
Yeah, and then, like, also, there's one thing, like a fat tax.
Right.
Where, like, if a food has above a certain amount of fat
right.
per,
if
like,
the food
gram.
Is crap, should we charge, like, a vice tax, you know,
yeah, like because you're gonna end up like with cardiac, like
syntax.
You're gonna end up with like hard.
Yeah, because ultimately, if we all have to pay for it, that seems like it's like the cigarette tax, isn't it?
Yeah.
If a cigarette is that bad, but we don't want to be telling people you can't smoke cigarettes. Well, I don't know why we don't want to be telling them that. We tell them they can't smoke marijuana, so I don't know why we would tell them you can't smoke marijuana. But you can drink alcohol, which is, you know, way worse for you. So we're drawing the lines based on a kind of a patchwork.
What about like regulations, as in like you can't sell a cup that's bigger than this? Like you're regulating how much people can do.
Right. Well, we're regulations are different than taxing it.
Yeah.
So those are not the same thing.
Yeah.
I understand though trying to have public health measures so that we're not all just buried in sick people that we just don't have the resources to fix. And when people are drinking like several quarts of sugary soda, but they've already lost one foot and two toes on the other foot, okay, if you want to be left alone to do as you please, but if we're leaving you alone, then why are you asking us to pay for it when we have to carving it up? Those amputations cost tens of thousands of dollars. And we have to pay it. You were out of money. You haven't worked in 20 years, you know. So if I have to have responsibility for taking care of you, then I should probably consider whether at least it's a good idea to say, if I have to take care of you, then here's some crap you're not going to do.
Yeah. What about the other side of the argument? Like if I say, like, if you're not a health, like say you don't work out once, like should we mandate everyone has to work out 3 times a week?
Right.
Like what? Like the other side, you could go over regulation and say, what about people, like you have to do this because otherwise you're going to be unhealthy.
How about you start with a certain tax basis that is to pay for everybody's health care? And it doesn't matter, you know, if you do certain behaviors that are appropriate for you. I mean, if you're born and your legs don't work, or you're in a wheelchair, then there's a sliding scale. But if you can move the upper half, you can at least do curls, or you can do a hand bike, or whatever. And then what you're doing is lowering your taxes. Every calorie you burn is taking pennies off of your taxes that year. Maybe that would work. It would make people suffer less. You know, it would make mental health needs less if people exercise a lot less. So, but can we tell other people what to do in the first place?
Yeah.
Should we be up in their business about everything? Because pretty soon now we've decided what they can eat. We've decided about their exercise. We've for years told them who they can have sex with. We've told people how they can make money. We tell people that they can't gamble. We tell people that they can't charge somebody to sleep with them. Unless you go to a zone where it's okay and we tax it, you know. So it falls apart when we like set up little, say, no, you can't do that. Well, okay, we can do it here, but you have to pay a license or you have to tax you for it. Oh, now your moral lesson is out the window. It is for sale, and now why are you telling me I can't do it? It's huge. So political science isn't simple. When you hear people getting up on their stump and just raving one way or the other for what's going on in our government right now or against what's going on in our government right now, you know, it's kind of like at the end of the day yelling about whether I'm prettier or you're prettier. It comes down to what you want to happen, and people want different things to happen. And it's not simple. It's not simple at all. I want to show you a little film. Okay. The film is the film version of Edwin Abbott's Flatland. That's what's printed in very, very, very unreadable small print on my tie. This will make sense to you when you see it in light of what we've talked about with Plato's cave, and in light of what we talked about with, even before we talked about the cave, remember me drawing dimensions on the board with Cartesian coordinate systems and talking to you about the fifth dimension and tesseracts and all of that? This speaks directly to that. Let's roll back.
There must be a fourth dimension, perhaps more. Fourth dimension, indeed.
They were mathematics, reason, and imagination will help reveal the truth.